The Life of St Cuthbert, Bishop of Lindisfarne, by the Venerable Bede, translated by J. A. Giles, read by Peter Wickham for Ukemi Audiobooks. Introduction. The Venerable Bede was born in 673 in Northumberland, became a monk, and died at Jarrow in 735. His modern feast day is May the 25th. He was one of the most important intellects and most prolific writers of his time. Among his other accomplishments was in becoming the only Englishman in Dante's Divine Comedy. His most important work is the Ecclesiastical History of the English People, but he wrote many others, biblical commentaries and hagiography in particular. Hagiography, the biography of the life, work, and miracles of a saint or an important ecclesiastical figure, was one of the primary forms in early Christian literature, particularly the medieval period, used by all the traditions, Roman Catholic, Eastern Orthodox, and Oriental Orthodox, including the Coptic and Syriac churches. These accounts of notable religious figures were reverential and often uncritical in content and tone, with the purpose of evoking an inspirational response in the reader. They were often initially written in the local vernacular, but increasingly Latin-dominated. Embellishments of the lives with uninhibited legendary accomplishments, especially miracles, became crucial elements of the stories. One of the best-known compilations of hagiography in the West was the Golden Legend of Jacob de Voragne, 1230 to 1298. Bede's Life of St Cuthbert, Vita Prosaica Sancto Cuthbertae Lindisfarnensis Episcopi, recounts the life of Cuthbert, circa 634 to 687, famed in his time as a miracle worker. Cuthbert was probably born in Northumberland and was educated by Irish monks at Melrose Abbey. At various times in his life, Cuthbert was a monk, a solitary, and briefly, a bishop. He died on Farne Island in 687. His feast day is March the 20th. An early anonymous life of Cuthbert was written about 700, but reports of the discovery of Cuthbert's incorrupt body, perfectly preserved, a decade after his death, gave a new impetus to the cult. Bede used the earlier life to write his own verse life around 716, and this longer prose life around 721. This includes 10 chapters of new material derived from Herefrith. Both the anonymous life in 7 manuscripts and Bede's life in 38 manuscripts survive. Bede's version was used for 2 famous 12th century illuminated manuscripts, now in Oxford University and the British Museum. Relics. The relics of St Cuthbert have a particularly well-documented history. As indicated, it was the discovery of the incorrupt body which led Bede to write. In 875, after the second Viking raid on Lindisfarne, the body was moved to Northumbria and rested at several sites until in 995 the casket was moved to Durham and enshrined there on September the 4th, 999. There it was visited by William the Conqueror in 1069. Later it was moved to Durham Cathedral. In 1104, when Cuthbert had been dead 418 years, the casket was opened, leading to further reports that the body was found to be still smelling sweet and incorrupt. Throughout the Middle Ages, Durham was the major pilgrimage centre of the north of England, and Cuthbert, the most famous saint, perhaps the most famous in England before the death of Thomas Becket. The commissioners of Henry VIII were sent to destroy the tomb in 1537. Archbishop Charles of Glasgow, who wrote a history of St Cuthbert published in 1849, wrote, "Dr. Lee, Dr. Henley and Mr. Blytheman, on approaching the shrine, found many valuable and goodly jewels. After the spoil of his ornaments and jewels, they approached near his body, expecting nothing but dust and ashes. But perceiving the chest he lay in strongly bound with iron, the goldsmith broke it open, when they found him lying whole, incorrupt, with his face bare, and his beard as of a fortnight's growth, and all the vestments about him as he was accustomed to say mass. The monks were allowed to bury him on the ground under where the shrine had been. This was opened again in 1827, at which time a skeleton, swathed in decayed robes, was found. The designs matched those described in the 1104 accounts, although some argued the real body was elsewhere. The Life of St Cuthbert by the Venerable Bede. Preface. To the Holy and Most Blessed Father Bishop Edfrid, and to all the congregation of brothers also who serve Christ in the island of Lindisfarne, Bede, your faithful fellow servant, sends greeting. Inasmuch as you bade me, my beloved, prefix to the book which I have written at your request about the life of our Father Cuthbert of blessed memory, some preface, as I usually do, by which its readers might become acquainted with your desire and my readiness to gratify it, it has seemed good to me, by way of preface, to recall to the minds of those among you who know, and to make known to those readers who were before ignorant thereof, how that I have not presumed without minute investigation to write any of the deeds of so great a man, nor without the most accurate examination of credible witnesses to hand over what I had written to be transcribed. Moreover, when I learnt from those who knew the beginning, the middle, and the end of his glorious life and conversation, I sometimes inserted the names of these my authors to establish the truth of my narrative, and thus ventured to put my pen to paper and to write. But when my work was arranged, but still kept back from publication, I frequently submitted it for perusal and for correction to our reverend brother Hereford the priest and others, who for a long time had well known the life and conversation of that man of God. Some faults were, at their suggestion, carefully amended, and thus, every scruple being utterly removed, I have taken care to commit to writing what I clearly ascertained to be the truth, and to bring it into your presence also, my brethren, in order that by the judgment of your authority, what I have written might be either corrected, if false, or certified to be true. Whilst with God's assistance I was so engaged, and my book was read during 2 days by the elders and teachers of your congregation, and was accurately weighed and examined in all its parts, there was nothing at all found which required to be altered, but everything which I had written was, by common consent, pronounced worthy to be read without any hesitation, and to be handed over to be copied by such as by zeal for religion should be disposed to do so. But you also, in my presence, added many other facts of no less importance than what I had written concerning the life and virtues of that blessed man, and which well deserved to be mentioned, if I had not thought it unmeet to insert new matter into a work which, after due deliberation, I considered to be perfect. Furthermore, I have thought right to admonish your gracious company that, as I have not delayed to render prompt obedience to your commands, so you also may not be slow to confer on me the reward of your intercession. But when you read this book, and in pious recollection of that holy father, lift up your souls with ardour in aspiration for the heavenly kingdom, do not forget to entreat the divine clemency in favour of my littleness, in as far as I may deserve both at present with singleness of mind to long for, and hereafter in perfect happiness to behold the goodness of our Lord in the land of the living. But also, when I am defunct, pray ye for the redemption of my soul, for I was your friend and faithful servant. Offer up masses for me, and enroll my name among your own, for you also, most holy prelate, remember to have promised this to me, and in testimony of such future enrolment, you gave orders to your pious brother Guthfrid that he should even now enrol my name in the white book of your holy congregation. And may your holiness know that I already have written in heroic verse, as well as in this prose work which I offer to you, the life of this same our father beloved by God, somewhat more briefly indeed, but nevertheless in the same order, because some of our brethren entreated the same of me. And if you wish to have those verses, you can obtain from me a copy of them. In the preface of that work, I promised that I would write more fully at another time of his life and miracles, which promise, in my present work, I have, as far as God has allowed me, done my best to perform. Wherefore, it is my prayer for you that Almighty God may deign to guard your holinesses in peace and safety, dearest brethren and masters of mine. Amen. Chapter 1. How Cuthbert, the child of God, was warned by a child of his future bishopric. The beginning of our history of the life of the blessed Cuthbert is hallowed by Jeremiah the prophet, who, in exaltation of the anchorite's perfect state, says, "It is good for a man when he hath borne the yoke from his youth. He shall sit alone and shall be silent, because he shall raise himself above himself." For inspired by the sweetness of this good, Cuthbert, the man of God, from his early youth bent his neck beneath the yoke of the monastic institution, and when occasion presented itself, having laid fast hold of the anchoretic life, he rejoiced to sit apart for no small space of time, and for the sweetness of divine meditation to hold his tongue silent from human colloquy. But that he should be able to do this in his advanced years was the effect of God's grace inciting him gradually to the way of truth from his early childhood. For even to the 8th year of his life, which is the first year of boyhood succeeding to infancy, he gave his mind to such plays and enjoyments alone as boys delight in, so that it might be testified of him as it was of Samuel. Moreover, Cuthbert knew not yet the Lord, neither had the voice of the Lord been revealed to him. Such was the panegyric of his boyhood, who in more ripened age was destined perfectly to know the Lord, and opening the ears of his mind to imbibe the voice of God. He took delight, as we have stated, in mirth and clamour, and as was natural at his age, rejoiced to attach himself to the company of other boys, and to share in their sports. And because he was agile by nature and of a quick mind, he often prevailed over them in their boyish contests, and frequently, when the rest were tired, he alone would hold out, and look triumphantly around to see if any remained to contend with him for victory. For in jumping, running, wrestling, or any other bodily exercise, he boasted that he could surpass all those who were of the same age, and even some that were older than himself. For when he was a child, he knew as a child, he thought as a child. But afterwards, when he became a man, he most abundantly laid aside all those childish things. And indeed, divine providence found from the first a worthy preceptor to curb the sallies of his youthful mind. For as Trumwin of blessed memory told me on the authority of Cuthbert himself, there were one day some customary games going on in a field, and a large number of boys were got together, amongst whom was Cuthbert. And in the excitement of boyish whims, several of them began to bend their bodies into various unnatural forms. On a sudden, one of them, apparently about 3 years old, runs up to Cuthbert and in a firm tone exhorts him not to indulge in idle play and follies, but to cultivate the powers of his mind as well as those of his body. When Cuthbert made light of his advice, the boy fell to the ground and shed tears bitterly. The rest run up to console him, but he persists in weeping. They ask him why he burst out crying so unexpectedly. At length he made answer, and turning to Cuthbert, who was trying to comfort him, "Why," said he, "do you, holy Cuthbert, priest and prelate, give yourself up to these things which are so opposite to your nature and rank. It does not become you to be playing among children when the Lord has appointed you to be a teacher of virtue even to those who are older than yourself." Cuthbert, being a boy of a good disposition, heard these words with evident attention, and pacifying the crying child with affectionate caresses, immediately abandoned his vain sports and, returning home, began from that moment to exhibit an unusual decision both of mind and character, as if the same spirit which had spoken outwardly to him by the mouth of the boy were now beginning to exert its influence inwardly in his heart. Nor ought we to be surprised that the same God can restrain the levity of a child by the mouth of a child, who made even the dumb beast to speak when he would check the folly of the prophet. And truly it is said in his honour, "Out of the mouth of babes and sucklings hast thou perfected praise." Chapter 2. How he became lame with a swelling in his knee, and was cured by an angel. But because to everyone who hath shall be given, and he shall have abundance, that is, to everyone who hath the determination and the love of virtue, shall be given by divine providence an abundance of these things, since Cuthbert, the child of God, carefully retained in his mind what he had received from the admonition of man, he was thought worthy also of being comforted by the company and conversation of angels. For his knee was seized with a sudden pain, and began to swell into a large tumour. The nerves of his thigh became contracted, and he was obliged to walk lamely, dragging after him his diseased leg, until at length the pain increased, and he was unable to walk at all. One day he had been carried out of doors by the attendants, and was reclining in the open air, when he suddenly saw at a distance a man on horseback approaching, clothed in white garments, and honourable to be looked upon, and the horse too on which he sat was of incomparable beauty. He drew near to Cuthbert, and saluted him mildly, and asked him, as in jest, whether he had no civilities to show to such a guest. "Yes," said the other, "I should be most ready to jump up and offer you all the attention in my power, were I not for my sins held bound by this infirmity. For I have long had this painful swelling in my knee, and no physician with all his care has yet been able to heal me." The man, leaping from his horse, began to look earnestly at the diseased knee. Presently he said, "Boil some wheaten flour in milk, and apply the poultice warm to the swelling, and you will be well." Having said this, he again mounted his horse and departed. Cuthbert did as he was told, and after a few days was well. He at once perceived that it was an angel who had given him the advice, and sent by him who formerly deigned to send his archangel Raphael to restore the eyesight of Tobit. If anyone think it incredible that an angel should appear on horseback, let him read the history of the Maccabees, in which angels are said to have come on horseback to the assistance of Judas Maccabeus, and to defend God's own temple. Chapter 3. How he changed the winds by prayer, and brought the scattered ships safe to land. From this time the lad, becoming devoted to the Lord, as he afterwards assured his friends, often prayed to God amid dangers that surrounded him, and was defended by angelic assistance. Nay, even in behalf of others who were in any danger, his benevolent piety sent forth prayers to God, and he was heard by him who listens to the cry of the poor, and the men were rescued out of all their tribulations. There is, moreover, a monastery lying towards the south, not far from the mouth of the river Tyne, at that time consisting of monks, but now changed, like all other human things, by time, and inhabited by a noble company of virgins dedicated to Christ. Now, as these pious servants of God were gone to bring from a distance, in ships, up the above-named river, some timber for the use of the monastery, and had already come opposite the place where they were to bring the ships to land, behold, a violent wind rising from the west carried away their ships and scattered them to a distance from the river's mouth. The brethren, seeing this from the monastery, launched some boats into the river and tried to succour those who were on board the vessels, but were unable because the force of the tide and violence of the winds overcame them. In despair, therefore, of human aid, they had recourse to God, and issuing forth from the monastery, they gathered themselves together on a point of rock near which the vessels were tossing in the sea. Here they bent their knees and supplicated the Lord for those whom they saw under such imminent danger of destruction. But the divine will was in no haste to grant these vows, however earnest. And this was without a doubt in order that it might be seen what effect was in Cuthbert's prayers. For there was a large multitude of people standing on the other bank of the river, and Cuthbert also was among them. Whilst the monks were looking on in sorrow, seeing the vessels, five in number, hurried rapidly out to sea, so that they looked like five seabirds on the waves, the multitude began to deride their manner of life, as if they had deserved to suffer this loss by abandoning the usual modes of life and framing for themselves new rules by which to guide their conduct. Cuthbert restrained the insults of the blasphemers, saying, "What are you doing, my brethren, in thus reviling those whom you see hurried to destruction? Would it not be better and more humane to entreat the Lord in their behalf than thus to take delight in their misfortunes?" But the rustics, turning on him with angry minds and angry mouths, exclaimed, "Nobody shall pray for them. May God spare none of them, for they have taken away from men the ancient rites and customs, and how the new ones are to be attended."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.